Hey guys, how's it going? My name is Matt from the JaYoe Nation. I'm joined by Daniel Dumbrill, Alex from Refortify Media, and Zoe. Today we have a very interesting topic. We are going to talk about North Korea, but we're going to talk about it in a unique context, the context of an expat who actually lives and works there for a considerable amount of time. We have come into a lucky interaction with Zoe here, and it was a connection made by Alex, and he'll talk a little bit about that. But before we get started, let me just chime in and say that we are actually live on multiple channels here. So if we if you have a question or a comment during this discussion, feel free to put it in the comment section, and we will try to go through it and answer it, as long as it's not crazy political. This is less about a situation of North Korean politics and more about North Korean culture and life, which is something that not a lot of people talk about. It's always missiles and craziness. So I think all of us have actually been to or had interactions with North Korea. And so this is going to be a very interesting and apolitical or atypical conversation regarding North Korea, because a lot of times people talk about it with actually no feet on the ground, but we have feet on the ground. So real quick about me, my name is Matt from the JaYoe Nation. Typically, I'm traveling around China and the world, trying to cycle around the world when a pandemic is not ruining my plans. So now I'm here in China, and I'm talking on live streams and doing traveling around China. But we are also joined by Alex. Alex, introduce yourself.
Hi, everyone. It's Alex from Reportify Media, and thank you for having me on today here. Matt, we spoke about a couple weeks ago about this idea, and I'm really glad that we're here today. My channel is basically based, as you say, as around traveling as well. I just recently came back from China in January and was locked out as the world pandemic has taken fire here. So still managing to put out really good content, and I'm going to hand it over to Daniel Dumbrill. Everybody knows him.
Well, not for sure. So yeah, I'm Daniel Dumbrill. I've been here in China for 12 years. Luckily didn't leave. I almost got locked out if I went to Hong Kong as I previously planned, but luckily I'm here. I own a brew pub here, and I have a channel, and I speak, I do a lot of political stuff. So this is going to be an odd one. This is going to be one where we're not getting political and later on as to why that is. But yeah, here we are. And then yeah, pass it over.
Zoe?
Hey guys, I'm Zoe from Zoe Discovers. I'm from the UK originally and usually live in China, but I have also been locked out since January when I decided to leave and have kind of ended up from that in Tonga. So currently on my YouTube channel on Zoe Discovers, I'm blogging about Tonga and life in Tonga. If you don't know where that is, it's in the middle of nowhere in the South Pacific. But usually I spend pretty much a third of the year in North Korea as a tour guide for Koryo tours. Yeah. And I've been working there for about 3 years now.
Nice.
I want to apologize. Zoe. I called you Zoe.
It's fine.
That's exactly why when I was passing it over, I didn't say that. I was like, hold on a second. I'm pretty sure it's Zoe, but everybody's calling you Zoe.
The most important is, how do the North Koreans address you for this episode?
That's really funny, because North Koreans, like, Korea doesn't have the Z. Actually very similar to Chinese and lots of languages around the world. They don't have the Z sound, so I'm always Joey. They always call me Joey. So you guys can call me Joey too. Yeah.
Let me ask, because you're in a very unique part of the world. You are as remote, I think, as you can get outside of like Easter Island. You are in the middle of, how did you end up in Tonga?
It's a very long story that I won't bore you with, but basically I ended up here because I was traveling the South Pacific. As soon as I left China, I actually went to South Korea to do a 2-week language course. That's why I left. And then I planned to go back to China after that. And then as soon as I left mid-January, things started to look a bit weird in China. So I was like, hey, I'm going to, you know, push my holiday forwards. I originally planned to go to Fiji, so I pushed that forwards a little bit, went off to Fiji, and then things got kind of crazy and crazier in China. Didn't want to go back and do quarantine, blah, blah, blah. Then it turned into government quarantine. And then I came to Tonga for a weekend because I was experiencing awful COVID anxiety and stuff in Fiji. There were too many tourists. So I came to Tonga for a weekend. And after that, they went into lockdown. But super interesting, Tonga's one of the only seven countries now. Marshall Islands got COVID 2 days ago. So one of the only seven countries in the world without COVID-19. So I'm pretty lucky.
Stuck in boring.
Sounds
paradise.
Like a good choice then.
Yeah. It's boring though. Yeah, for sure.
So tell us, how did you decide and how did work in North Korea come about? I mean, that's kind of a unique job. How did you come across that job?
So basically it came from, most people who work in North Korea have been there as a tourist before. Most people, at least who work in the tourism industry. And basically I first went there because I was living in Japan at the time, and this was 4 or 5 years ago, and it was during the refugee crisis, the European refugee crisis. And a lot of my Japanese friends would tell me, oh, hey, you're from the UK. That's really cool. We really want to go there, but it's too dangerous at the moment. And everyone started talking about my country like it was a war zone, like it was really crazy. And for someone to talk about my country, the UK, like that, it really shocked me, and I realized how much of an impact the media must have. So I decided I wanted to see North Korea for itself and see if the media is really right about what it's like there. So I decided to go. And the main thing that I discovered there was that it was all pretty normal and that there are real people that live there. They're not like crazy brainwashed people walking around. They're real people. And I kind of wanted to, I mean, it's easy to dehumanize the North Koreans, but I kind of wanted to show people in the world, hey, you know, actually, there are people that live here too. It's not all government and politics. I kind of wanted to, in a weird way, like give the Koreans a voice. Yeah, so I decided to start working there.
That is a lot of what gets lost, isn't it, is those personal stories, because it's always about the politics, it's always about what's big in the news, and that's why I'm excited about this too, because I'm sure all of us during our interactions there we ran into some really interesting people, had interesting stories, and they were, you know, especially the first time you go there, just far more ordinary than you would ever think, but we don't get to hear about them much, so this is going to be exciting.
You know, I have a few clips that I pulled from a SD card that finally made its way to my house. That was a story in itself, with getting the SD card of Zoe's travels. But we'll start with one clip. I'm going to show a clip and we can discuss it. And the reason I want to play this clip first is because we see Chinese or North Korean officials and people that are dressed up to the nines, and we impart our idea of what these hardened people are like. And this is sort of a humanizing conversation that you had with somebody. I think this is at the DMZ.
And, oh, okay.
all you have to do is look at this guy's smile, and you can tell how genuine this guy is as a person and an individual, not a North Korean fill in the blank. So, let's take a look at this clip.
What's your name? He likes to pretend he doesn't speak English.
제 이름은 원철입니다.
So, how long have you been working at the DMZ?
About 10 years.
10 years? Wow. So, you've seen many foreigners in that time? 외국인 많이.
네, 많이.
많이.
상관 보장을 많이 했습니다.
And do you enjoy your job here?
직업을 사랑하나?
제 직업을 사랑합니다.
Really? It's interesting. 재미있습니까?
적을 지키는 게 용해로운 사업이지.
You mean that it's honor to defend the country.
Oh, that's very good. Yeah, cool. And it's always a pleasure seeing you every time.
매번 올 때마다 만나서 반가웠답니다.
저 역시 그렇습니다.
Oh, that's so lovely.
You're your skin tone has changed considerably from those clips.
I haven't seen these clips since I haven't even had a chance to look at this content since I left. This was filmed just at the start of this year, when travel was still a kind of thing, and I haven't seen any of it. So it's just so nice to see it all again.
So who was that? Can you tell us about who that individual was?
Yeah, he's one of the tour guides at the DMZ, basically the demilitarized zone, which is Panmunjom, the border of North and South Korea. And I've worked with him like a few times. So some places in North Korea that you go to, like for example, a museum or something like that, they have local guides that are obviously more like specialized in where they take you around than the Korean guides who, you know, have a general overlook. And so this guy takes people around the DMZ. He does the same job all the time. And like, there's sometimes there can be like 2, 3, 4, 5 tours a day in peak season. So, you know, he gets bored of it and stuff. We just have a laugh.
Yeah. Daniel, you, Alex and Daniel, both you've been to the DMZ, right?
Yeah.
Did you go, Daniel?
I did, yeah, from the north side. Yeah, I haven't been from the south side, but I have been the north side.
I've been from the south side.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. I've never actually been from the south side. Yeah.
Yeah. No. When did you all go to North Korea? So, Alex, I don't know. Mine was, I think it was 2013. When was your visit?
Mine would have been about five years ago. And I actually never went there planning to go to the demilitarized zone, but it's hard to avoid. Trust me, as soon as you're in Seoul, you see this. You also have to give them a fair amount of warning to go down there so that they register you at the UN to get approval. And you have to go through a bit of a process before you go down there. You just can't get in your car and drive down there.
When you say you didn't plan on going to the DMZ, you planned on going to North Korea though, because it's not like the kind of place where you said, "Oh, I missed my exit. Oh shit, I'm in North Korea now."
took a left when I should have taken a right.
I understand what you're saying, but it was very moving, and I have a story to tell you guys later about it. So
yeah, it's cool. I got one from the DMZ too. But and Matt, did you go to North Korea also? You were in there.
I've been into North Korea. I actually ran a marathon there. The
oh nice.
I mean, and the year? What year was that?
2015, I think.
2015. Okay, got it.
16.
Yep.
It was after my Everest plans got squashed the first time. So yeah, but you know, the reason I find that video interesting is that I met that guy. I probably interacted with those people, but I was there and then I was gone. And you have this opportunity to found deeper friendships and relationships with these people in a way that you might be able to see even a more broad spectrum of emotions and you can actually see a lot. Like, most of us are there on a tour, you know, so we're there and then we're gone, you know, but you're able to go there and interact and kind of like learn more about the people there. And I'm curious, what are some things that you noticed as you were there that they were particularly North Korean? Everybody has a certain type of culture, certain type of traits. And I'm wondering, what was it about the North Koreans that kind of made them special to you?
That's a really good question. The Koreans, I mean, also, we've got to remember that the North Koreans and the South Koreans, they weren't separated so long ago. So when I speak about Koreans, it's generally about Koreans, like North and South. They're still very similar in a lot of their cultural habits and stuff like that. Incredibly polite. They have lots of social rituals, very similar to in Japan and stuff like that. I don't know if this differs so much from South Koreans, because I haven't spent so much time in the South as well, but I think the North Koreans, they just like to have a laugh and a joke a lot. I think this is very typically different in North Korea because of their circumstance, but I find the naive in a very kind of cute way. They have access to a lot of outside information and stuff like that. like a lot more than you might think, but also they, a lot of things, for example, relationships and dating and stuff like that, like the girls or the guys and stuff, they are very naive when they talk about those kind of topics. So it's really lovely to be able to kind of chat to them about those kind of things. And I think they're very, very shy when it comes to that, much like speaking to maybe when you're 14 or 15 and you're speaking to like your girl pals or your gal pals or whatever, and you have those kind of like naive, cute conversations. I have those with the girls. Yeah, so, but in terms of Koreans, really, they're very similar to South Koreans. They have a very deep-rooted culture.
Yeah. I've got a question if I can ask Zoe.
Sure.
Public display of affection inside North Korea with people. I mean, you've been in there. How many times have you been to North Korea?
So I've been just under 30 times. I think I'm on to 27 now. Usually, generally, I'll go about on average once a month. During non-pandemic times, but it depends. Sometimes during the summer, I'll go 3 times a month. And then during the winter, I'll go 1 time every 3 months. But as to your question, it's very interesting actually, because it's one of the things that's changing noticeably in North Korea, is that, public displays of affection. So the way I describe dating in North Korea is like, imagine 1950s England or whatever. So it's very, guys go courting with girls. They take them out for a walk. Maybe there's one park. There's one park that's very, very popular to go for dates because it's very beautiful and stuff. And you often see couples in there. They will just be sitting together, kind of close, but not like touching, maybe reading a book together, stuff like that. And in terms of public displays of affection, absolutely none. However, recently, in the last couple of years, there has been a little bit of hand-holding, stuff like that. And I asked my colleagues about this, and they said it's becoming more and more common.
Okay.
Yeah. If you don't mind, actually, because there's a lot of things we could talk about in this, but maybe we could like back it up to the beginning, because I'm actually kind of curious about the beginning when you tell your family and your friends you're going to work in North Korea, like how the beginning of the journey starts. How you get to that point, first of all, and then what the process was like and the kinds of reactions you got from your family and friends. I'm really curious about that.
Yeah. So basically, it started because I was about to graduate from university and looking for a job. And then I saw on Facebook an advertisement for a job. And it was one of the few places that I'd ever thought, whilst I was on the tour, I was like, hey, I can do this job. So that kind of, it kind of manifested in my mind for a while, and I kept thinking about it. And then this advertisement popped up on Facebook. So I was like, okay, well, I'm just going to go for it and move to China. And I mean, my parents, whilst they're incredibly supportive of me, they have very different views on it. So the first time that I went to North Korea as a tourist, I remember telling my mom, like I said, I was living in Japan. And I remember telling my mom, and she said, she was crying on the phone and said, you know, if I go to North Korea, I'm breaking her heart. She said, and I told her, like, listen, mom, like, just because I had never done any research, it surprised me to find out that you can go to North Korea. I never knew that you could. So I told her, listen, just Google it for 5 minutes, just read about the tourism in North Korea, and then I will listen to your opinion. Then, you know, then you can tell me what you think. But she came back to me and said, I won't even put that word into Google. So I was like, well, I'm not really gonna listen to your opinion then. My dad, he thinks it's super cool. We were supposed to be in North Korea this May. He booked to come and see me in China, and then we were both gonna go to North Korea in May together because that's my favorite time in North Korea. And then obviously COVID happened, so hopefully next year he'll be able to see.
So he hasn't been before.
He's never been before. No.
Okay, that's really interesting. And then your friends, like any kinds of interesting reactions from your friends?
Not really, to be honest, because I do a lot of weird traveling and stuff like that. Oh, okay. Anyway, so people are just kind of like, oh, okay, Zoe's working in North Korea.
the story about your parents is kind of the same. Yeah, the story about your parents is kind of the same. So when I went, I asked my dad if he wanted to come, and he was visiting me in China at that time. And my mom, same kind of thing. My dad was like, this is cool, you know? And he got his Batman, he wore a Batman t-shirt to go to North Korea. And he was like, yeah, he's like, I'm really into this. But the day that we were leaving for our flight to Beijing, the bathroom door, the handle broke, and he was locked inside the bathroom, and my dad, and he couldn't get out, and then my mom said, you see, it's a sign, you shouldn't go.
No way, that's hilarious.
And we ended up going, and we had a really great time, and I'll get into some of the stories later, but we're interested to hear some more of your stories and what the first journey was like then also.
Yeah, I mean, I can talk a little bit about the first journey. I actually went to a really bizarre place in North Korea for my first time similar to me being like traveling to weird places and stuff like that. I never want to do the norm. So I didn't go to Pyongyang when I first went to North Korea. I went to this place in the very, very northeast bordering Russia called Rason. And it's probably one of the least explored places in North Korea. The company that I work for do one trip there. It's very interesting because it's basically what Hong Kong is to China in a way. It is the special economic zone of North Korea. So it's where all the trade goes on, and it's the only place in North Korea where you can see a market as well. And so it was just really eye-opening to me how normal it was. And the way that I came out of North Korea in the same way that pretty much everyone comes out of North Korea after a trip. I don't know if you guys experienced this as well, but it was kind of, you don't really know how to describe it. People ask you, like, how was it? How was your trip? And you're like, well, it was fun, but then, you know, it also wasn't. And it was weird, and it was, you know, there's no real way to describe it because you're kind of underwhelmed. I call it pleasantly underwhelmed because it's not all military parades and craziness, and you can take pictures, and you can do this, and you can do that. Mm-hmm. So you're kind of underwhelmed, but in a nice way. Yeah.
But they do, like the process when you enter, I'm sorry, Alex.
No problem.
When the process when they enter through the airport, they still inspect your phone, they inspect your camera. I mean, they do take measures that could be somewhat intimidating. But once, at least when I was there, as soon as I got past the airport and I was on that, I would 2 a.m. dark bus from the airport all the way to... It was a funny moment. I was driving from the airport to Pyongyang, and it was pitch black. The roads had no street lights. And then they said, oh, out there, see our beautiful city. It's very well lit. And they had like one section of apartments that was 100% lit. And I'm like, did they ask those people to turn on their light just as we drove by? Because it was very odd to see all those lights at 2 a.m. You know,
Yeah. That's weird. Yeah. I think they shoot themselves in the foot sometimes when,
they try too hard.
Yeah, exactly.
Sorry, Alex, I know you've got a question, but I think one of the things that when they try too hard is they know also there's some people that are going to come in and they come in with they already come in with all of their conclusions and they know what they're going to leave with. And so I remember our tour guide, he was actually a really funny guy and he knew a lot about the outside world. And he was saying that, you know, like, for example, they come in and then they go to a part of the city where there's the old playground, which is decommissioned and it's falling apart. It's rusting and stuff like that. So this used to be our playground. This is how big it was. Then they go and take them to show them the new playground, beautiful, everything like that. But when they go back and they're vlogging and their news and everything like that, they only show the old one and say, you see, this is what, you know, North Korea is like. It's crumbling and stuff like that. So I think that they try to overcompensate for some of these people. They say, okay, we know what's going on, and they try to manage it too much. But yeah. But Alex, sorry, you've been waiting. You've been trying to ask a question here for a bit.
Yeah, and, interesting. I've got maybe a little bit of a strange question, and I hope you can answer it. But, you know, we come from a lot of these countries that have billboards and advertisements wherever you go. I mean, we don't recognize, we don't realize it, but, you know, we're walking down the street and we're being promoted for new cars, computers, or everything. Yeah. What is it like to go to a country in modern day today that I'm under the impression that there's probably hardly any marketing or anything like that going on in that country. To see clean streets without any major billboards or, you know, am I missing something? Is there more going on there? Or is it picking up? Or, you know, what does it feel like inside you there?
Absolutely. And actually, the most interesting thing is not being there and not being around all the advertisements and the, you know, the, like, not being around dirty streets and homeless people and stuff like that. The weird thing is coming out of it. And because I'd spent a lot of time in China as well, and you don't see, you know, a lot of homelessness and stuff like that as well, I just remember the biggest shock for me was going back to the UK after, I think I'd been about in China for about 2 years. And I went back to the UK and I just remember seeing like just advertisements everywhere and like TV, watching TV, because I also don't watch TV in China. So like watching TV and being around like adverts and stuff like that. And then on the streets, just people, homeless, drunk people, people on drugs, stuff like that. Really shocking to me. And I remember like, yes, I remember saying to a friend, like there was this guy who looked really, really rough standing in the middle of the street. And it was the most horrific sight. And I said to my friend, like, you know, what's going on here? Like, is he okay? Should we help him? And my friend was just like, oh no, you know, he's just on drugs. Let's go. And I was just like, the desensitization is crazy. So for me, like when you're in, like for me, we find North Korea so crazy and stuff like that. There's so many aspects that the Western world finds crazy about North Korea. However, I always think to myself, what do you think that the North Koreans would feel like if they went to America? You know, this place that's meant to be, you know, full of dreams, and it's meant to be like, we're all meant to look up to America. But then you see all the issues in the society as well. I think that they would be just as shocked as we are, like hearing about North Korea.
When I was there, well, just to add, the you know, one of the things I noticed was like I was actually shocked, Alex, like the lack of signage. It's shocking. It's like there is something missing.
Oh,
here,
that's,
you know,
yeah.
it took me a second, and like one thing I remember is pastels. Like there was a lot of pastel,
yes,
colors.
Yeah.
You know, things are painted in pastels, and there is signage, but
it's all
very
propaganda.
Specific. Yeah, it's like a fork and a knife, right? Or a fork and a spoon. That's the eating place, and then a
oh,
book,
yeah,
and then that's a library. And
yes, yeah, that's right? True. That's true. It's funny because I think that a lot of people think that there is no signage because a lot of people can't read or understand Korean. So a lot of people say to me when we're on tour, like, hey Zoe, where are all the shops? Where are all the restaurants and stuff like that? And I'm like, oh, well, you know, that one's there, that one's there. And it's because you can't read Korean. So I think a part of it gets a bit lost in the translation, so you can't see where things are exactly. But you're totally right. Like it's, for example, a shop will be called shop. You know, a restaurant will be called Korean restaurant or Chinese restaurant or whatever. There's not so much marketing and branding and stuff like that. Although that is starting to come out, there are some advertisements that you'll see, but it is mainly propaganda.
You know, Zoe, just you saying that there are shops and restaurants right there actually raises a lot of people's eyebrows, because people would say, what do you mean there's restaurants inside, you know, Pyongyang in North Korea? What restaurants? They don't have restaurants there. They don't have shopping malls there. So tell us, a normal North Korean person, for example, on a Saturday afternoon, what would a North Korean person, let's say somebody that's living in, you know, a central Pyongyang, what are their choices to do on a Saturday? We'll call it, we'll generalize it into the commerce aspect. What would they do?
So they're because of their like culture and stuff, they would generally, I spend a lot of time with their family, to be honest, and because they're working a lot, a lot of the time they work 6 days weeks as well, but it depends on their job. But to be honest, a lot of the time that they spend when they're not working is just kind of chilling out with family. But they also have the options to kind of go to, I mean, over weekend, to things like Munsu Water Park. The massive water park is very busy. I just want to say before I start talking as well that, you said like the average North Korean What I'm going to talk about right now is the average North Korean living in Pyongyang. And Pyongyang is a kind of bubble in itself, like most capital cities in the world. You know, London is nothing like the rest of the UK, but Pyongyang is, you know, it's the upper, it's the middle upper class. So there are so many like things to do. There's bowling, there's the ice skating rink, there's, you know, just kind of normal people things. And in terms of the restaurants and cafes, there's a very cool, chic kind of Starbucks kind of cafes that are popping up now. There's quite a few of them. I like to kind of test them all out. And there's a range of restaurants as well, really, from like a lot of them are Korean food, but more often the Koreans, just like everyone else, they like foreign stuff. So they like to go to, you know, Japanese restaurants, Chinese restaurants, or burger. There's like a McDonald's or a KFC and stuff like that. It's obviously not real McDonald's or KFC, but they sell the same kind of fast food stuff.
Do they make a good burger there?
Go to these places. So many people will just say, oh, you know, they're just here for show and stuff. And I remember, like, it was actually at the start of January when I was there. I had some time without some tourists. So it's just me there. And I was talking with the guides where we were going to have dinner tonight. And actually, there was a few of us that got together. We had a kind of, you know, tourism business meeting. So there was maybe five or six of us. And anyway, we decided on going to this one restaurant, which was a Japanese restaurant. And we walked in and the waitress was like, I'm really sorry, like, we're full, we have no seats, blah, blah, blah. And so we had to go and find another place. And for me, that was just so like, it's not set up, you know, like it's so, everyone says it's fake and it's all for you and stuff. And it's like, well, they haven't got any seats in the restaurant for us, so we're going to have to go somewhere else. And, you know, to have a restaurant so full as well, it was just kind of fun.
Yeah. They have brew pubs too. A lot of places brew their own beer there.
Yeah, they do. They do.
Oh my God.
Yeah,
they,
the best beer I've ever had was in,
right? So much better than Chinese beer, and so much better than South Korean beer. Even the South Koreans agree with me on that. Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. But seeing this stuff and seeing how normal it is, I think that is definitely a shock. You know, before I went, I was really looking forward to seeing this like backward place that's just stuck in time. And, you know, I went to Cuba before and that was really cool because they had the embargo and, well, that's not cool. It's not cool they had the embargo, but I mean, they couldn't get any new cars. So they were all like old classic cars on the road. And it was like you were in like a 1950s, 1960s film. It was amazing. And so in North Korea, I was like, oh man, this is going to be amazing. And the first thing I see when I get out of the airport is a DHL truck. I'm like, oh, come on. That's a buzzkill. This is a photo I took at the train station. I love this one. This is I don't think we were supposed to take pictures at the train station. I was like, I gotta get a picture of this. Like, it was just a family smiling with each other. The older man there, he was apparently heading out on a trip to like the northern areas of North Korea or something like that, and he was like just saying goodbye to his family at the train station before he headed off to work. And look at the smiles. Like, this is the stuff, like, you know, people think people are going to be walking around like, you know, drones. But it was an amazing experience. Yeah. That's one of my favorite shots. Oh, there's I'm going to get, somebody's going to use this one now on me when they're.
Yeah, you got it. You got it.
It looks like I got a Kim cut before I went, too.
Yeah, you suited.
It wasn't deliberate. It wasn't deliberate. But yeah, no. Oh, so we're going through all my pictures, I guess.
Yeah, is that okay? We can go through.
Yeah, we'll go through. So this one, I went to what was the last MASS games at that time, and they stopped it for a while, and I had a really good zoom lens. So what I did was I took a wide photo, and then I zoomed in on the kids, and I was fascinated because, like, I was zoomed in, and I was watching what they were doing, and they were kind of, like, laughing and joking with each other and stuff like that. And then when it was time to change the cards, you know, they change the cards and the whole image changes, boom, they do it really quickly all together. So it was really cool zooming in and seeing the little faces behind this, because again, this is like, usually you see it from afar and just see this like conformity, because I think a lot of people have seen this on YouTube before where they change the cards and then it changes the images totally. It's amazing. But behind those cards are ordinary little kids, you know?
Zoe, did you go to a lot of those, big events with, you know, the stands at, Kim Il, Kim Il, Kim Il Sung Stadium, right? Kim.
So that one's at the Mayday Stadium, actually. The Kim Il Sung Stadium is slightly smaller. The Mayday Stadium is one of the biggest in the world. Yeah, that's the Kim Il Sung Stadium. Where the marathon is held. Yeah, I've been to the MAS Games too many times now, but two instances that really stand out to me are usually when you go on the first night of the MAS Games, then sometimes Kim Jong-un is there to attend the first night, and the past two times that I went, he was there. So apart from, you know, being like, okay, you know, Kim Jong-un's here, it's an incredible atmosphere, just an incredible atmosphere, because everybody is kind of going crazy. You know, everyone stands up, and it's a very mental celebrity atmosphere.
I've got
how many times have you been in the same area as him? I mean, have you?
That's twice. Yeah, I mean, there's two.
Just twice.
Yeah.
Okay. Alex, my question for you, Zoe, is: I mean, if you look at North Korea on the map, if you pull up the Google map, you see it has a lot of little islands that are just off the coast a little bit there, and I mean, how do they control the ferry system there? I mean, I know these might sound like odd questions, but this has always been a fascination of mine. And that's how I actually met you, is because I very seldom, you know, once in a while, go on YouTube and put in Pyongyang or North Korea to see what new video comes up. And I saw yours and I thought, wow, this is interesting. What's this girl doing there? And it was fascinating because it was video footage that I had never seen on other channels before. So my question is that if you're a North Korean and you're going to the beach for the day and you see an island across there, I mean, do people move within the country easily that way, or can they visit the islands if they've got a relative there? I mean, how does that work? How does this whole, you know, there's bits and pieces that, you know, as we all say, that this is a closed off, you can't get in, you can't really get out, but there are little islands just off the shore there. So I'm just curious, you know, what's going on in these places.
So there's three aspects to that I kind of want to answer to. The first one is about the islands specifically. I have no idea, to be honest, how people get to and from the different islands. I don't know if any of them are inhabited, and if they are inhabited, but if they're super, I mean, there's lots and lots of kind of boats and fisher boats and stuff like that all over the coast. So I guess if they really wanted to, then they could go to a different island. But we also have to remember that North Koreans are not like the kind of adventure travel hasn't quite really hit them there yet. And I can't really imagine a Korean sat on the beach and being like, hey, that's a cool island. Let's hire a boat and go over there. I can't imagine them being that interested in doing something like that. But there's various ferry services that take you, for example, from Pyongyang to Nampo, and Nampo's on the west coast. It's actually one of my favorite places to go to. So you can get the ferry there, but you can also drive there, stuff like that. But yeah, in terms of the islands, to be honest, no idea. In terms of travel around the country, popular. So domestic travel is definitely hitting the country much more. It's not easy to travel. You can't just pick up your bags and say like, hey, let's go away for the weekend, kids. It has to be planned in advance. You do have to ask for special permissions. In terms of going to Pyongyang, that's probably one of the most difficult places to get to. For the Pyongyangers, it's easier for them to travel. And indeed, a lot of them do, you know, maybe they want to go to, there's a couple of places that are quite popular. One is Nampo, that's only about 2 hours drive from Pyongyang. And then another one is Wonsan, which is famous for Kim Jong-un having his area there with Dennis Rodman and stuff. And then they may go further afield as well. But generally, domestic travel is, I would say, just kind of starting. And the third thing I wanted to mention as well, you said it's kind of hard to get in, hard to get out. I think a common misconception as well is that the North Koreans can't travel abroad. And when we're talking in terms of travel as a tourist, this is generally true. However, there are, I mean, I'm sure you guys in China have probably met or heard of someone who's met or heard that there are lots and lots of North Koreans in China. So there's thousands abroad in China, in North Korea, in China and in Russia. And usually they're doing business, they're studying, or they're doing sports and they're sponsored to kind of go abroad, that kind of thing. So they can't, there are lots and lots of North Koreans abroad. Yeah.
Real quick, I actually, the person that was in my marathon, she, the one of the minders, she was, she had been to Europe. Yeah, I was very surprised that she had been to Europe, came back to North Korea, and she was doing her thing. Let me, real quick, I have a friend, Jason, who's been on my, one of my subscribers for a very long time. He actually went to the marathon after he watched my video, and he gave us a super chat. So he says, I'll return to North Korea in 2021 with Koryo Tours.
Nice, that's it.
Rich and Simon was my tour guide last time. Do you know Rich and Simon?
Of course, Rich and Simon.
I love Rich. I'm good. I'm good. I'm close with him too.
Rich.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. He's in Mongolia, I think, right now. He's in
Mongolia.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we got a super sticker from Chelinghi, and thank you, Chelinghi. That was probably better. And then Ken Winger, this is an incredible, informative live discussion. Well done, guys and gal. So thanks, Ken. Interesting chat on all of our channels. So thank you.
I just want to let everybody know whoever is monitoring my chat, I don't have access to it. So that's okay. But anyway, I just want to say to the moderators on my feed, take care of everyone on there. I'm not sure what everyone's saying, but hopefully you guys are enjoying the show. Zoe, I got one other question. Now, since this is really special to me to actually be able to ask somebody that's been in there so many times. I mean, little things like if your car breaks down or if your refrigerator breaks down or something. I mean, you know, how does a daily life as a person go on there? I mean, do they get to choose the profession? Like when they're growing up, they say, okay, I want to be a mechanic or I want to, you know, study computer electronics. I mean, tell us, have you ever been into a conversation like that with someone before in South Korea?
Yeah, often. So I've never asked the what do you do when your car breaks down question, but I imagine it would be pretty similar to what we do or what I kind of did the other day when I had to change a tire. I just looked helpless on the road and some Tongan guys came to help me. But in terms of deciding, you know, what you want to do when you get older, what job you want to do. Basically, it works like you will go, most Koreans are very highly educated, especially in Pyongyang. Many of them will go to university and it's all free as well. So they'll go to university and then you kind of like base what you want to do on the what you studied at university. So most of the North Korean guides that we work with, they'll have studied at the tourism college, or they'll have studied English, or they'll have studied, you know, something relevant to the field. And then what they do is they basically say, like, they kind of have a list of things that they want to do, and then apply for the job. So the being a North Korean tour guide is probably one of the most prestigious jobs, without kind of talking about like government jobs and stuff like that. So it's definitely a very prestigious job. You're the face of the country and you get to work with foreigners all the time. So it's very difficult to get into, and they go through the same process that we go to. You know, you apply for jobs, you go for interviews, if you're accepted, blah, 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 then you're accepted. In terms of, for example, buying a house or indeed choosing where to live or like getting a house, because you don't buy a house in North Korea. What you'll kind of do is you will you're assigned a house from the state, and you're assigned this base. You're not just told, hey, you've got to live here, it's really inconvenient for you, so sorry about that, but you're living here. You're assigned a house based on a kind of application that you'll put through, and you'll say, like, you know, I work here, my family live here, I have a wife and I have three kids, so you know, do something with that. And then the government come back and be like, okay, cool, we'll make sure that, you know, you live in this area close to your friends and your family, and it has two bedrooms, three bedrooms, whatever, because that's what you need for your family size. Yeah.
Well, but, did you say just earlier on, did you say that the university is free for them?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, wow. Okay. What about, I'm curious, what about healthcare? Like, is it semi-subsidized
or? All free.
Healthcare and university is free.
Yeah. And housing is free. Okay. They do pay for electricity and water, but they tell me it's buttons, it's pennies, it's, you know, it's just kind of a token fee. But it's, yeah. So housing, and yeah, housing is free and stuff like that.
It's just so fascinating that this country of what we, about 24 million, 25 million, somewhere around there.
Mm-hmm.
Is that about right?
Yeah.
You know, continues to run in when it's kind of almost cut off from the rest of the world here. You know, they're cut off, and correct me if I'm wrong, you're inside there or you've been inside there many times, but cut off from e-commerce platforms, cut off from, you know, worldwide banking systems. Can I actually make a phone call to someone in North Korea? I mean, what is their calling code number? And all these things is like, when you have a nation of 24 million people that is, you know, I don't want to use the word cut off, but let's just say they're on their own. I mean, how does commerce work? Do they have a tax system that pays for this healthcare? How do all these things just manage to come together? And it's, and for this civilization of 20 some million people to live, that fascinates me. That absolutely fascinates me.
Yeah, I guess it's instead of in our societies, we kind of envision it all going up. So we have money and therefore we buy things and then things kind of go up the tiers. But in their society, it kind of trickles down. So, you know, they don't make a lot of money from their wages. And in all honesty, that's one of the questions that you'll never, I don't know if any of my colleagues have ever, but also I don't like to probe too much if they don't want to talk about it, but I've never got a straight answer in terms of wages. But I know that they're very little because basically the state provides for everything. And what your wages do is then add to that for any like luxuries and stuff like that that you want to do, go to the cinema, whatever. So you have all of your basic things. They get, I'm going to call them rations because that's what they are, but not in terms of rations, like war rations, how we might think of them, but they get a certain food allowance a week, they get housing, and then they get healthcare and education. So all kind of like the basics. And then their wages kind of add on to that.
That's the basis of communism, is that the you know, the government
it must be coming from like state owned enterprises or
everything is state owned.
And then it like you said, it trickles down. Well, that's amazing that they still like Alex was saying, as cut off as they are from the world, they're still providing free university, free housing, free medical, everything like that.
And not just cut off as well, but they're also like, they have to deal with all of the sanctions and stuff like that that's posed to them from the US. So, you know, they have to kind of deal with that as well.
And things would definitely change if those were lightened up. Daniel, do you want to go first? Because I've got a question. Do you have a question?
Continue with your story?
What's Daniel? That? Sorry. That was just an interesting point to sink in, is that that all those things are provided for free, and it's a very different way of doing things. But yeah, what did you guys have other questions, or do we want to get in into our own most interesting stories in North Korea?
Yeah. Why don't we do that? Then we'll bounce back to Zoe a little bit later. But let's go into our personal experiences in North Korea. Do you want me to go to DD04, or do you want me to go to the story?
All right. So I'll start. First of all, without the pictures, I'll just kind of generally talk about, because my trip was a single trip, so it's pretty easy to sum up. So it was interesting. Yeah, like I said, I came out of the airport and saw a DHL truck, and I was like, "What is this? I'm here to see a country that is closed off from the rest of the world, and I'm starting to see that it's not as closed off as I thought. That's actually a good thing, but it wasn't what I was expecting." Going around, it was interesting to see a lot of places brewing their own beer. They had a brew pub in the bowling alley. Restaurants were brewing their own beer and stuff like that. A lot of local ingredients. Going around the city, our tour guide, he was really on top of things. He knew so much more about the outside world than I expected, and he was really witty also. You know, I remember when we were in the subway, they were showing us the subway system, and there was an American guy on our tour, and he looked at he looked at us and he was saying, you see, like, there's no smiles on their faces, you know, something like that. And then our tour guide quickly looked at him and he said, it's 8 o'clock in the morning and they're going to work. Are people walking around on Wall Street with smiles on their faces? Like, what are you talking about?
Yeah, exactly.
but he was pretty witty. There was another one too, because he knew my reference to Julian Assange also, because when we were at the bowling alley, when we were finished, we were heading to the DMZ, and we drank quite a lot of beer at the bowling alley. And then, so we're on the road and all of a sudden I'm like, oh man, I drank way too much beer. We need to find a bathroom. And I'm waiting, and finally I'm like, I don't know what to do. And I looked back and there was an Australian guy with this panicked look on his face. We didn't even need to say anything because we knew we both were drinking the same amount of beer. And he just nodded to me. I said, yeah. And then we're like, okay, we gotta stop the bus. And so they're like, no, you can't stop here. You have to wait. And I said, well, I tried my hardest. I got to go here on the bus then. I really can't do anything else. And so he says, okay, wait. So they pull over the side of the bus. The two of us get out. We find a place at the side of the road. The Australian guy finishes first, goes back, and he says, where's Daniel? And he says, oh, he's still at it. He's still going. And finally, I come back in. I'm like, okay, thank you. I'm so sorry. And then I sit down, and we start going. And I say to our tour guide, I say, you know, I know this is a sensitive area, you know, you could have gotten trouble and stuff, and maybe, you know, we're going to see stuff that we shouldn't see. And I said, but you know, on the bright side, this brings a whole new meaning to WikiLeaks. And he understood the joke. He got the joke. He got the, yeah, I know. I was doing dad jokes even before my first was born, or he was born around that year. But, and he laughed. He was like, ha, he's like, sit down. and then we continue on. As we get closer to the DMZ, one of my favorite stories happens. So there's this American Vietnam vet. There he is. He's sitting and he starts having a conversation through. Oh, so that's the guy who in the middle, who I was saying he knows a lot more than, you know, he's the guy who said, sit down, Daniel. So this American guy starts having this conversation with this North Korean military guy, and through this translator. And what was remarkable was the North Korean guy was asking really deep, meaningful questions. Like, for example, the American soldiers that are stationed in South Korea, are they there out of a sense of duty, or do they do it just because it's a job? And also, like, would you want, when your kids grow up, to also join the military? And all of these really deep, interesting questions that the average person from the outside would think that these people don't have the capability because they're just mindless drones. This is what we're fed all the time, that, mm-hmm. you know, there's no independent thought. And I was just deeply interested in what he was saying. Then, if we want to go on to the next picture. So they start walking. They're still talking. And look, I'm coming out of the side of the picture. And then what ends up happening, if we move to the next picture, is he ends up giving this North Korean guy a gift. It was like some sort of an American military pendant or something like that. And he said he wanted to give it as a token of, you know, friendship, and ended up giving him this, like, a U.S. military thing, no less. And it was just so touching. And then they continued. You can go to the next picture. They continued walking and talking with each other. And it was like, that was an amazing exchange between two people you would never, ever expect to make a connection with each other. And I actually got concerned. I asked our tour guide. I said, you know, he's giving him a U.S. military thing. Isn't he going to get, like, in trouble or something like that? And he just looked at me. He said, you really like your Western media, don't you? and there I am on the DMZ on the north side. DMZ. I did the whole trip. If you want to go to the picture with where I'm with the kids, this is in Pyongyang. I took a picture with the kids. They were a bit nervous, but the mom was really happy. He's like, yeah, take a picture. But I don't know if you realize, I was one of those idiots wearing those five finger shoes when they came out. There's another picture of he's even this guy. Even this guy's looking at me like, what are you doing? And I'm like, no, these are really cool, man. It's like, this is the natural way you're supposed to walk. But really, the North Korean, like, you should have seen some of the looks I got from the North Koreans. Like, first of all, you're a foreigner there. And then it's got this weird dude with these things on his feet. They're like, everything we heard about foreigners is true. They're from another planet.
Daniel, but yeah, I knew there was something off about you, brother.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. But it was an amazing trip. And then we took the train back also. So that's something Americans aren't allowed to take the train in and out. Everybody else is, we flew into Pyongyang and then finally we came back on the train. And the same kind of thing when you were talking, the thing that connected with me, Alex, was when you were talking about billboards, because when we were in the northern area of North Korea, and then we cross over into, is it Dandong, I think it is, or what, on the, whatever, on the north side, and then boom, lights, you know, cars and all this stuff. Yeah. And it was an amazing transition. Now, mind you, of course, in the northern areas of North Korea, there's not much there anyways, but it was still an interesting trip going through and seeing the villagers and looking at them as we were going along. But overall, just an amazing trip that left a lasting impression, that's for sure.
When you're driving from Pyongyang to the DMZ, you see a side of North Korea that you do not see in Pyongyang. I mean, you see the countryside, you see the arid landscape, you see a broken road. I mean, the road to the DMZ is the largest, widest road. And it's, in some cases, very dilapidated. In some sections, it's very surprising.
The guides call it a free massage.
The suspension on those buses gets tested, right?
Yeah, I think from a infrastructure point of view, it's probably, you know, it's all built with military considerations, the width for, you know, in case there was, I mean, because, you know, there are still tensions, so, you know, the right width for tanks and all that kind of stuff. But
main artery.
Yeah.
Mm. Let's bounce back to Zoe for a second, and we'll go to Alex and his story. But Zoe, I have some more video clips here, and so I'm going to play a video clip with audio. And then I'd like you to talk about it. She doesn't know about the clips I'm pulling, so it'll be interesting to hear her take on it.
Okay, go on.
Okay. And I fuzzed out, you know, all the naughty parts. So I was just joking.
Okay, so I'm about to test out the first run at the Massive Young Ski Resort. I haven't been skiing in a while. And I hope this is, it looks like a green run. So it should be pretty easy. Woo! And there goes Mr. Lee.
Okay, so now put this in context. I don't know if a lot of you guys know this, but it's fairly recently finished, this ski resort in North Korea that was has been a pretty big project of Kim Jong-un to build this thing. And so tell us about it. What was it like there? It's quite beautiful, it looks like.
Super cool. Yeah, I mean, I'm not like a super big skier, but I definitely enjoy skiing. And I've been to this area of Korea only in the summertime. So to kind of see it, like you guys can see it right now, covered in a blanket of snow. It's just an incredibly kind of beautiful place. It's not the biggest ski resort in the world, but there's I can't remember how many slopes, around 10 or 12, maybe somewhere between 10 and 20. But it's very new, and that what you can see it to the right-hand side, that's the hotel right there. And the rooms in there are incredible. It's one of the few places that has like a, what do we call it, like, so you can access the internet in there if you have one of those cables for your computer, which I didn't have. And everything in, just like everything in a lot of the new builds and stuff, it's just very clean, pristine. They have a lot of equipment. I can't remember where the equipment came from, but potentially Switzerland or Germany or something like that. But a very new equipment. The one thing that they don't have is their own snowboard. So if you want a snowboard, then you have to bring your own. But all like brand new equipment. It's just like a normal ski resort, I guess. I don't really know what else to say about it. It's got bars. It's got restaurants. Yeah.
You mentioned, I guess it would be a LAN connection or something for the internet. Can you go into what that means about the internet? I mean, first of all, as a foreigner, you're in that country. I'm just relying on what I hear, that we don't have access to the internet while we're there. And number two, my question to follow up after that is, how do North Koreans communicate within the country to each other? Do they use an application? Do they have an intranet in the country, or? I'll forward that off to you. So
I'll talk about the internet for foreigners there first. If anyone's like really interested, I have like a super quick 2-minute video on my own YouTube. But just very quickly, you go to North Korea and you presume that you're not going to have any internet. It is possible to get internet in North Korea, but it is, I'm pretty sure I can say this with confidence, the most expensive internet in the world. For example, if I'm in charge of like the social media and the company and stuff, and if I'm doing like Instagram stories, like very limited usage, maybe one story or something like that, I can easily spend 50 or 60 euros in 2 or 3 days in North Korea on internet. And that is just using data alone. That's not including buying the SIM card, which is about $200, and doing the registration and stuff like that. So luckily, I have the same SIM card every time I go, so I don't need to buy it each time. But it's incredibly expensive and takes a long time to set up, and it's not always possible. So basically, you won't have internet when you go to North Korea. There are very few places. There's the airport and one hotel has Wi-Fi. But again, you shouldn't rely on being able to use this, because you can't just, in the middle of a tour, you can't just be like, oh, hey, can we go and use the Wi-Fi for an hour? You know, I mean, you can, if the whole group wants to do that, then you can go to the hotel and use the Wi-Fi for an hour. But it's expensive and there's no point.
The reason I stop you is because this is an interesting topic, actually. I'm going to show another clip of New Year's, the countdown to New Year's that you recorded, Zoe. And I'd like everybody to kind of look at all of the smartphones that people have. And then afterwards, I'd like you to talk about who's sharing those pictures, where are they sharing them through? And that's kind of an interesting topic. So let's watch this. Also, note, it's a pretty normal New Year's celebration, as would happen anywhere in the world. So let's take a look at this. Okay, so that looked like a lot of fun.
Yeah, I have a lot to say about New Year's in North Korea this year, but I just want to point out that very anticlimactic 3-2-1. It's basically they counted down from like 60 seconds.
That was a long clip.
Yeah, they counted down from 60 to 30, and then the last 30 seconds was this like video presentation that they put together, and then they had the fireworks. It was very like anticlimactic. But yeah, you can see the smartphones for yourself. Point. Most people would think like, you know, how do they communicate? Do they even have smartphones? Mm-hmm. Do they even have phones? Yes, that's one of the biggest things that's kind of changed in the past few years, especially. A lot of them have smartphones. A lot of them even have two smartphones. Like, you can't avoid smartphone culture anywhere, I guess. This is in Pyongyang. In the countryside, they'll definitely have less smartphones and stuff like that. But in Pyongyang, for sure, everyone has a smartphone. They love taking, like, in the past year, actually, I have to admit, this is one of the biggest differences that I found, is they've just got onto the whole, like, taking photos on your phone thing, which I guess that they may not have had before, because they had cameras on their smartphones before, but they didn't have the whole, like, why would we take this picture kind of thing. And I guess their cameras were maybe not so good. But I swear, like, their new phones, they have two phone companies, the Pyongyang and the Arirang. And those cameras are amazing on them, like iPhone kind of quality. They're really, really good. So they now, get cameras.
Is there an intranet there where, like WeChat? In China, they use WeChat. Is there, like, what is that called?
So there is an intranet in North Korea, but social media has not hit there yet. Mm-hmm. I recently read an article today that a touchless, a contactless pay system is now in the country. Obviously, I'm not there to see it, but that suggests that there could now be a kind of more social media network or kind of network there. But they have intranet, and it's only to access what we would call the internet. So if you want to Google something, then North Korea has its own kind of world. And that's within that world, you can Google stuff. But in terms of social media,
if somebody wanted to send a message to their cousin or niece, right. nephew in another part of the country. That's no problem doing that?
Yeah, but they would use text. So they just wouldn't use, like, they wouldn't contact via Messenger or WhatsApp. They would just use text. And I've seen them a lot. Like, they text each other like we text friends and stuff, you know? Like, they're using emojis and they're using, like, they're making jokes. They're not just... It used to be a very, very call, phone call kind of culture. Mm-hmm. And especially within
the old days.
Especially within the girls, like, I see them, like, texting and, like, gossiping a lot on their phones, just kind of chatting about nothing, how we would text. But before that is definitely, I still think that they prefer calling as well.
Now, one more question.
When you mentioned,
go ahead, Daniel. Sorry.
Just a quick one. You mentioned about the phones. So you said there were two phone companies there. So are they making their own smartphones? Like, it's a local homegrown? Oh, wow. Okay. Hmm. I wouldn't have thought they would have had the facilities for that, but...
I mean, their phones are incredibly similar in platform and in look to a certain other Chinese phone. But I'm not speculating here.
Okay. Yeah.
You know...
I'm sorry. Always... One more thing, Alex, because Calibri Wings just dropped a super chat.
Oh, thank you.
Given the limitations, what are the options for those who see ambitions outside of the available life and career? Can you actually go outside and be an artist if you've started the path on an engineering degree? Can you break rank in that sort of a way? Is that not allowed?
Yep, you can break rank. I was talking to one of my good friends who works in the Northeast. He is a tour guide. Obviously, that's how I know him. And he, the last time I talked to him, he said that he was planning on quitting and doing a 2-year business course or something like that. He wanted to go into business. And then another person who I was speaking to said that they wanted to become a professional volleyball player or something. I can't remember which sport it was, but it's possible to change course. It's a little bit harder, but also all of it's still paid for by the state. So if you decide, hey, I don't like this job, I want to go and do a course in business, then you don't have to worry about not having a job and stuff like that, because you don't have to fund too much yourself. It's more difficult than it is for us, but so it's possible.
Here comes more bizarre questions from Alex. You know, each nation has its challenges, you know, and, you know, in some cultures, they have rule of law. And inside North Korea, for example, let's say a married couple aren't getting along. Is there a divorce court there? Is there kind of like, you know, courts that decide if somebody was, you know, I don't know, got into a car accident? Is there... You know, who decides these kind of, you know, problems in a country like this?
Oh, so they have the court there. I'm not sure. I mean, I've asked about divorce and stuff like that, and it's becoming just like a 1950s kind of England thing. It's frowned upon, but it's becoming more popular. Not popular, but it's happening more often. So that if divorce happens, and stuff like that. But in terms of like how it's taken to court, I actually don't know. I've never asked. Yeah.
Interesting.
Alex,
whenever you guys
are
ready,
why don't you share your story?
Well, you know, you were talking earlier about, you know, we were talking about in Korea and the differences about, you know, promotion. And so I decided when I was in Seoul, you know, to go with my wife down to the DMZ, we call it. And this is a photo here of the other side, guys, showing you where I went. And, you know, from North Korea, you'd be on the other side there. And those two little lines there, those are the South Korean, you know, uniformed soldiers. And then you can see just in the distance there, there's the North Koreans. And inside these little blue, I guess we'll just call them pavilions, there's a line that says, you know, you are now in North Korea. You are now in, you know, in Korea. And the interesting thing is when we were taking a bus tour down there, they had a North Korean defector on board with us. And, you know, they were asking her a lot of questions. Everybody on the bus was putting up their hands, asking, you know, the usual questions we all would see in the paper, you know, do they keep the lights on past 10? Is it staged? The bizarre types of questions that, of course, most foreigners would just generally throw out there to ask her. And I put up my hand on the bus and I said, I got one question for you. And I said, what do you miss about North Korea since you're, living in Seoul now? And I wasn't ready for this answer, but her answer was everything. And that silenced the bus. And I was quite taken back by that. I was expecting her to say, I don't miss anything. And she went on about a 5-minute talk about what she meant. And she said, well, I have new challenges now. One is I have to really find a job that will enable me to actually live into this, apartment, to get grow. I never had these worries before. And now I have these worries. I have a mortgage payment worry. And it's like you've taken somebody out that has had a very structured life and brought them into, and she was going into it about chaos. And, it was a pretty heartwarming story. And, we don't really think about that because we're used to being in our Western countries. Yes, we got to get a job. We pay our taxes. We pay our mortgage. But to hear somebody that, that is not the answer I was expecting. And to hear that,
Between the time that you asked the question and she answered the question, what kind of looks or reaction did you get from the people on the bus? Were they just like, what the heck are you asking?
Everybody on the bus turned around at me and said, what kind of question is that? Almost like it was an insensitive question for me to ask. I'm serious. They all, on the bus, they all kind of turned around and said, who is this guy? What's he talking about? And generally, I know I ask odd questions like, what's it like? Can you go to an island off of North Korea? these questions build in me. And that's why I'm so happy to have you on the program today, is because these are things that we're told, of course, somebody that is coming over is going to completely trash the place. That's what I'm told. But to hear that answer, it's kind of like, and she said to me, there's love in North Korea.
Yeah.
People love each other. They know their neighbors. Yeah. I mean, this program is not about the politics. And this program is trying to understand, to me, kind of what's going on a personal level inside of North Korea. And when I heard that from her, I was just, blown away.
It's a really big it's lovely story to hear, because I think it's a big misconception as well that, one, everyone is so impatient and desire to leave North Korea. That's definitely not true. And two, everyone thinks if a defector goes into South Korea or whatever, or gets out and goes to a different country, then suddenly, they're happy. Great. They're out. Finally, they're out. But there are many different layers to see of it. And it's funny as well, because I first experienced that kind of the shock from the Koreans in a similar way of like, oh, mortgage, blah, 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 because I was looking for a new place to live in Beijing, and it was at a time in summer, and I was in North Korea, in and out of North Korea, like pretty much, I'd go back to Beijing for a day and then come back. So I was like stressed, and I was trying to find a new place to live in Beijing, and I was talking to my colleagues there, the North Koreans, and I was like, oh, what do you think about this house? What do you think about this house? Showing them different pages, blah, blah, blah. And one of them was like, I'm glad that I don't have to do any of this. What trouble? Like, as if you have to find your own house and stuff like that. And I was like, oh yeah. Like, I'd never considered that before. And I was like, yeah, it is annoying. But yeah, it's things that you don't consider.
My question actually for Alex, because you, now Zoe, you haven't been to the DMZ on the south side, right?
No.
No, okay. So you've been on both on the north and the south side, right, Alex?
No, just the north. Pardon me, just the south side there. I think I've got a photo of me standing in front of the building there somewhere.
Oh, okay. That's exactly what I wanted to ask about, because the first interesting thing for me when you pulled up your picture from the DMZ was, it was interesting to see how the two South Korean soldiers are kind of hiding half of their body behind the building, and then on the North Korean side they're just kind of out in the open. Like that. It's like, kind of more, a little bit more open. But what was interesting for me was there was somebody on my trip who had been on the south side first. I had never been to South Korea at that point. But on the north side, it was really like easygoing. There were no rules about where you couldn't take pictures or where not to point your camera. But the guy on the trip, he said, whoa, this is totally different. On the south side, there's this guy that comes in with a really strict voice. Don't turn around and take a picture of this, of our own building. Don't do this. Don't look directly. Don't point towards this. Like really, really strict rules. So it must have been driving them crazy that we could take pictures of their building from the north side because they let us do whatever they wanted. But
yeah, you're not allowed to wave from the south side as well. So you can wave from the north and you can shout at
them. That's right. Yeah. Because my dad and I, that was the day my dad was wearing his Batman t-shirt and he was like, the American soldiers on the south side. Yeah. Where's my dad? Yeah. He's in the back. On the left. Behind the guy in the white shirt. And he's pointing his Batman shirt towards the south side and they're taking pictures of us. You can see the flashes coming from the building. We could, do whatever we wanted. It must have been driving them crazy. So Alex, when you were there on the south side, was it like really strict? Was it quite, at least when you went?
You know, the thing is that they really did make a big deal about getting approval. And I found them actually the most fascinating part is when I went into the gift shop and they allowed me to buy some North Korean cognac. I mean, my wife's going, what are you doing? And I said, where else can you buy North Korean cognac? You know, I bought a box of that and I pretty much cleaned out the little tourist shop that they had at the border down there because they weren't selling anything they were selling everything from North Korea on the south side. So I just said, I'll take it all. I even have I forgot to wear it today, but a DMZ cap sitting in my closet. And I cleaned it out because, you know, it's one of those things that, you know, all of us travel, okay? And we go to these places and we arrive and we get our bearings, you know, we open up our applications, we go on our maps. But boy, oh boy, I mean, traveling to North Korea must be amazing because that is the... You take all those things that we have and we've used around the world when we travel and you kind of bin them and you're arriving in the country where you might need a map. You know, you might need a map. And
definitely can't use Google Maps.
Right. So it's almost like, you know, in a way, as a traveler, hitting the reset button. And, you know, that's where I'm going. You know, Matt, yeah. I watched a couple of your videos. I mean, you know... about the marathon. I think you're going to talk about that.
I will.
I'm so curious to see what the feeling was like when you were doing that. So anyway, yeah.
All right. Real quick, Zoe was talking about, I think Daniel was bringing up the fact that, it's just interesting how, maybe it's in the comment section. I'm reading the comments. I'm listening to you guys all of us talk. I'm trying to put things together in my head. But somebody made a comment that was, why would North Korea use so much Western tech? But it seems they hate Western ideology. And it's funny because I was at the Anti-Imperial Museum. Have you been to that, Zoe? That museum is...
I think that that's the one of the few that they don't take people to anymore because it's quite intense.
It's in, oh my God, that place is so amazing. No people allowed inside. But this place was better than the Smithsonian. Oh my God, it was so interactive and interesting. And the tour guide, we walked through and we passed by, they have these bombs that they scavenged from like the ordnance that America dropped. And they said that the Americans infused these bombs with biological weapon engineered mosquitoes and that they were dropping them on the North Koreans and infecting them with malaria and different diseases and stuff. And I was like, whoa, that's great. Holy moly, you know? And then they had the ship there that they had, the American ship that they had docked there and a bunch of things. And so I was sitting next to the woman who is our guide and she was talking and I actually asked her, Alex, that's why I thought, because Alex had asked that woman sort of an awkward question. And it really wasn't. It was just an honest question. And so I went to the guide and I said, I'm American. Do you hate me? You know, I mean, like you. And then she looked at me and she said, we don't hate America. We just hate their government. You know, it's a very matter of fact kind of Totally. You know, they like us, and it's not even, I don't think it's necessarily against the ideology. It's just nuts and bolts. It's just, they're like, we just don't like your government. It's just that kind of a thing.
Totally. I think they love Western stuff. They love Western, like, foreign products, whatever. It has nothing to do with the government. And also, they don't hate, like, Americans. They hate, like, history and what happened and the essence Good of point. That. But they don't, like, people always, you know, sometimes Americans are not allowed to go to North Korea from the Trump travel ban. So it's not North Korea banning them, but, like, they can't go from, like, the US. There's a few other countries like that. And sometimes, you know, people are like, if we have an American on tour, they can travel by using, like, a different passport. Maybe they have a second passport or whatever. And they come to the country and, you know, sometimes they're super scared. Like, should I let anybody know that I'm American? Like, should I tell them? I'm like, they know. Come on, they can hear your accent. Like, it doesn't even matter if you're American or not. It's not that they hate you guys. They hate, like, America, you know, in what it's done and blah, blah, blah. But they don't hate you because you're American.
One personal question, Zoe. 30 stamps of North Korea in your passport. Does that ever get you pulled in for questioning?
Well,
they stamp outside your passport, right? They stamp outside my passport.
Yeah, so I only have 2 Korean stamps in my passport, and that's because there's only one area that stamps your passport, and only if you're lucky, and that's Rason. So that's the first place that I originally went to, and I've been there once since, and basically that's the only place that you get a stamp in your passport. It's been absolutely no problem. I've been to South Korea, stuff like that. The only problem is now I could probably never go to the US because I need a visa to go to the US, and I think one Google of my name, they probably wouldn't head there, but yeah.
Daniel, you know, you want to talk about that?
Oh, yeah, no, just because my dad showed up in the chat. So just a quick shout out to my dad. That's him in his Batman T-shirt. And
Hey,
there we go. And then that was facing towards the south side. We were just trolling them a bit. you know, one of the tour guides, she was an American tour guide on the trip. And she said that there was one time when she was going from Windsor to Detroit, and she was actually stopped for questioning, and they asked her why are you in North Korea and stuff like that. So they would have got her picture from the DMZ also, and they do actually question people sometimes about it. So that was quite interesting to hear too.
Ben Logic asks, is there pop culture like pop singers and such? There is, right?
Yes. And that's what made, like, New Year's one of my favorite times, because I got to see the Moranbong Band, who are like the Spice Girls of North Korea. They're just pretty much like the pop group. There are other pop groups and stuff like that, but you can find them on YouTube if you just search Moranbong Band.
But to ask that question, once again, I ask the bizarre questions, but I'm going to do it. How is music distributed in that country? By CD?
Yep. By every way that we have it distributed, apart from, like, Spotify and stuff like that. So I guess radio, CD,
a lot of them have vinyl. The good old days.
I don't think that they have vinyl, but a lot of them have, like, the DVD, you know, those small portable DVD players. Yeah. So I guess, you know, they'll play music in that. But otherwise, there's never a quiet moment in North Korea. There's music playing all the time, everywhere. Yeah.
Well, the wife of Kim Jong-un is one of the ex lead singers of one of those pop groups, right?
Yeah. The Moranbong Band, yeah.
When I flew from Shanghai to North Korea, they played them in the plane. Like, it was part of the whole introduction to the country.
Yeah, they're pretty like very funny, kind of happy songs, stuff like that. It's all about the government.
Zori, I guess you were in there a few times when there was, you know, you probably get these questions, where is he? He's not around. I mean, is there ever a worry about who is after Kim to be in control of the country? Is there a concern within the country, or does anyone know who's next?
There's no concern, for sure. I mean, he's super young. And there's no, there's no, I've asked a few of them and stuff. They have no idea who's next. And, you know, a lot of the North Korea watchers and stuff like that, the from outside North Korea, many think that it will be Kim Jong-un's sister. Mm-hmm. But it's all just speculation. No one could know, you know, I mean, the going into a coma and being ill and stuff like that, that's all completely fake news. So
when you're reading this stuff that's coming out on North Korea and from these think tanks or, you know, NGOs, do you kind of say, you know, where are you getting this information from? Because it's not what I'm seeing, or is it?
Yes, it depends. It entirely depends what they're reporting on and also what news outlet it is. If it's a reliable news source, I'll be like, oh, okay, like, let's look into more of this. If it's a dumb news outlet, I'll be like, okay, well, that's, you know, I know that that's not true. It just depends on my own knowledge and what they're reporting on.
Is politics a topic of discussion among normal North Koreans, or is it not really something anybody really talks about? It's just there.
Yeah, I think it's just there. I mean, as a tourist, you can talk about the politics, and lots of people do because it's a very interesting topic, and the Koreans like to tell people about it because we actually know very little about North Korean politics, I think, apart from like a lot of the base stuff. But yeah, I think the Koreans, they have nothing really to talk about it because, well, yeah. They don't really talk about their politics. And also, they respect the leaders. So talking about them and humanizing them is kind of disrespectful.
Priya asked, have anybody in North Korea seen the movie Parasite? I'm curious.
Yeah, I don't think that they... Well, there's probably a few people that have seen it. But in general, no, it's a very, very new film. A lot of Koreans managed to get their hands on some Western media and stuff like that. But this is a very new film. And the borders have been very shut, so I doubt it. But I think they would enjoy it.
Just one quick question for you, Zoe. Oh. And then, sorry, Daniel. How is it to how can someone, you know, with your organization, how difficult is it or how easy is it to plan a trip to North Korea? Like, how much time in advance would I need to? If I say I want to go to North Korea, what are the steps?
So it's actually super easy. And the biggest thing that you've got to worry about is getting your Chinese visa, because in order to get to North Korea, you have to go through China. And the Chinese visa process can be a little bit tricky. But you would need at least about 2 weeks, not that much, but 2 weeks gives us enough time to organize your North Korean visa, which is then you can consider your China visa as well, which you can also get around if you do the transit visa and stuff like that. So about 2 weeks.
Thank you.
Yeah, and it's a very smooth process, application online.
Regarding that, actually, I had a okay, so I saw one come in. I've just got my phone to the side here, and Commando Crossfire said, thank you for this amazing and fair chat on North Korea. I've always wanted to visit. Also, is it easy for a Canadian to visit? So I can say from firsthand experience, I also went with Croyo Tours. It was pretty easy, pretty straightforward. I was already in China, so that piece is the piece I didn't need to worry about. And I would imagine nothing has changed in that regard. It's not any more difficult for a Canadian, is it, Zoe? It should be pretty straightforward.
Yeah, same thing. Like, Canadians, absolutely no problem.
Yeah. And we can even do one thing more than the Americans can do, which I said was go on the train. I don't know if that's still the case now. Yes. So that's an interesting...
I have to go on the train. Yeah, you can either pick train or flight. Yeah. The only thing you've got to consider as well is if it's a busy time, you know, it can be that the tours get booked out as well. So...
Right. You know, that was good. I just wanted to mention something on the politics thing, is that one of the reasons I was saying that I was interested in this chat also, it was because we were just going to focus kind of on the people and stuff like that, which we've been doing so far. But yeah, the politics, yeah, like, you know, just ordinary people like this. You know, the thing is, I think what people need to keep in mind too is that...
is Daniel gone?
Sorry.
Hey, can you hear me?
You can still hear me? I'm here. I'm good. I think maybe Matt's side might have... It looks like he's frozen. Oh, our moderator dropped out.
Yeah, he's here.
It's it's because I was just somebody thought I was going to say something political and they kicked out the moderator. They were gonna here he comes. Yeah, no, there we go. Yeah, no, you know, I mean, I don't have enough information about North Korea to be able to talk about the political stuff. I see a lot of you know, shady stuff going on with the some of the testimonies and stuff like that. But I prepared myself. The way I prepared myself to go to North Korea before going was I read one of the most anti-North Korea books I could possibly think of. And it was dark, and it was like really it shocked me. And I was like, oh, man, I got to see what this is like for myself. And I didn't see anything that matched the book. Of course, people can say, well, you know, you just get shown what they show you. But afterwards, you know, I know firsthand from anti-China propaganda how different it is from actual reality. And it just so happens that the person who wrote that book also did some a book on China and also did some writing on China. And I was like, okay, this is so far disconnected from reality, because China is something I know about. But even with that, it's just so hard to break out of our conditioning when we're growing up, because even now, even I've gone and seen it for myself, even though I've seen the problematic testimonies, even though I've seen what that author of that book did, I still have I'm very much clouded in my perception of North Korea that I grew up with, and that's hard to break out of. I have some followers of mine on Twitter who are like pro North Korea, so to speak, and even that still gives me discomfort, even though I have, you know, I don't know anything about it. But it's so hard to talk about the politics part of it. But I think, like we were saying from the beginning, it's really nice for us to be able to talk about the people and stuff like that. And maybe in that regard, one question I have, pulling it back into that, is do you have people in North Korea, North Koreans, who you would consider your friend, who you would call your friend, and you know, kind of, you know, more about them than you would just an ordinary person in passing, you know, that kind of thing?
Yeah, for sure. And that's definitely one of the hardest parts about the job, because when you go on a tour to North Korea, as I'm sure you guys know, it's very intense and very full on, and you're with your guides all the time. Of course, mm-hmm. when you're in the hotel and stuff like that, you have chill out time. But actually, I don't, because when I'm in the hotel, then I'm planning for the next day and talking business and stuff with the guides. So I'm around those guides every single waking second of the day, really. And I love it. It's fine. You know, we chill out a lot, but you do get incredibly close with them. You know, when you spend so long with someone, for example, I think I calculated it. I spent about 60 days around 60 days in North Korea last year. And when you're around some people, and I work with the same guides a lot, of course, you're going to get close with them. However, you know, you still have to consider the fact it's dangerous, because you have to consider the fact that, one, you're colleagues and you'll work together, but two, you'll never truly be kind of part of each other's worlds. You know, once you're gone, like, then you don't talk to them, they don't talk to you. I always wonder, like, you know, do they think about me, blah, blah, blah. I, of course, think and talk about them all the time with my colleagues. But it's difficult having people in the country that you care about. One, because you know that they're there, and two, because you can't contact with them. So there is a way you can call North Korea, and of course, like, we do that when we need to talk to them for tourism and stuff like that, but I can't just pick up the phone and be like, hey guys, how's it doing? How's your baby? And stuff like that, you know?
Would it be possible,
since you do, let's say once the borders open up and travel is resuming, would it be possible for you to actually stay inside North Korea for example, for a month and not leave? Is that a possibility?
It's a possibility. And I did that last year, actually, on a tour. I was there for a month. But it has to be for a reason. I can't just be like, hey, I'm just going to pack up and go to North Korea for a month. No one can do that. You have to have a reason. And if I wanted to do that, I could do it. And I would give a month's itinerary to our North Korean travel partners and say, look, I'm going to be here for a month. These are all the things I'm going to do. When I get there, of course, I can change it around. But I can't just be in North Korea just because I want to. And also, if I did that, I can't say, we're always with two guides, right? And I would be there as in the capacity of a tourist. And I couldn't just go there and say, hey, I want to see this person, I want to see that person. I would be with the two guides that I've been assigned.
You know,
there's a guy that is living there, though, right? There's a guy, an American guy, who's living there. He was a defector, and he does like acting or something like
that. Yeah, yeah.
So have you ever managed to meet him?
I've never met him actually, which surprises me. I would imagine like seeing him in Pyongyang. Yeah, his son's also an actor. Yeah, there was a two or three of them that defected into North Korea from the US, from the South side. And yeah, there's only him still alive. It's a very interesting story. I've never met him though.
I mean, besides the Western tourists that are going there, I mean, China has also taken an interest in going into North Korea. I mean, how do the North Koreans view another market, coming, like the Chinese are traveling in there now as well?
Yeah,
so how do they view that?
The Chinese travelers are, if you talk about Western tourism to North Korea, is nothing compared to the Chinese tourism. Last year they had to restrict Chinese tourists to 1,000 per day. So that's how often the Chinese tourists are going into North Korea, especially during peak time. So the Chinese tourism market is absolutely massive, especially because from Dandong, which is the border city right in the north, in the northeast of China, it's just a 10-minute train journey away to get to the border city. So some of them go for the day, some of them make it all the way down to Pyongyang.
But what about their guides? Don't they need guides? Are they there without guides?
There with guides as well.
So but it's a big market.
the Chinese tourism groups are bigger. So we cap our tours at, my gosh, I have forgotten it now because I haven't done one in so long. Maybe 22 people, I think a little bit less. We cap our tours at that. But then the Chinese tour companies, maybe they can have 30, 40 people. There's lots of Chinese speaking guides. So the tour company that we work with is the biggest one, and they have about 100 Chinese speaking guides. But there are also various different companies within North Korea that work in tourism. So, yeah.
One of the tour shops I went to, I actually had to use, I ended up using Chinese, Mandarin, to communicate with them. Because they didn't speak English, and so that I think that shows it. I think they go out to the beach. There's a lot of beach destinations also, right? The Chinese go down. There's some beach destinations they go to in North Korea. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Did you meet Fun for Lewis when he came there? He's a YouTuber, pretty popular travel YouTuber. He went there and made a surfing documentary. Got him a bunch of grief, but he made a lot of friends there with the North Koreans.
I imagine. No, I wasn't involved in that, but very cool.
Daniel, Dandong, like they said, is on the border between North Korea and China, and it's a famed port city. Daniel, I wonder if you've heard those advertisements on Chinese television that roll back to back to back to back to back that are like, "Welcome to the port of Dandong."
Oh, Dandong, really? I've
never heard. Fantastic city in northeast China. Like,
what is this? Is it on TV or something? Or
Chinese television runs a Dandong, Dandong spot back to back. Chinese, they don't understand the idea.
I don't really watch TV, but that sounds pretty intense.
Pretty intense.
It was like I said, that the trip though, going across in the train, was amazing, and there was a really cool spot. I don't know if Zoe, have you taken the train back to Pyongyang before? You must have.
It's like my fourth home, you know.
Yeah. So when you take the train back, there's one particular spot. I know we went over to like the car, because you know when the train goes across, it connects up to a Chinese train, and then it continues with our existing cabins and those cabins. But then we walked over, a bunch of us walked over to the eating cabin, and then so you could see through clearly on both sides. And there was one part in Dongdang where it goes through, where it's this narrow track. You're going over this narrow track, and on both sides of you, there's roads and signs and everything like that. It looks like you're slicing right through the middle of the city. Busy stuff going. I don't know if it's in Dandong or a little bit further, but there's this one spot where the train goes through, and it's basically sandwiched in like right to your immediate left, right to your immediate right. There's like people on the streets and cars and shops and stuff like that. I can't remember what part it was in, but there's a stretch where it just seems amazing. You're ripping right through the middle of this city, but should have been in Dandong. It should have been right in that spot there.
Would that be like from the train from Beijing to Dandong? So like just before Dandong?
I saw it going the other way. I saw it going the other way. So yeah. And you've got to be like, if you're if you're in your cabin, you're not going to see it as well on both sides. But because the eating cabin was opened up, it was like the most amazing experience. And the contrast from what we had just left on the northern part of the border. It's quite interesting.
It is a big culture shock going back to China after being in North Korea.
Do they lock your doors on that train? I heard that they actually lock you in.
Yeah, they usually do.
Yeah.
Just any Chinese sleeper train, they lock the doors.
I've got a question, Matt. You know, and I was looking through the Courier Tours stuff on the marathon, and I found it quite interesting. I mean, if you got a moment, if you don't mind actually telling you know, me a bit about it. I've started to watch some of your videos on it, but how was that experience when you were there?
Okay, well, I was normally cycling around the world, but I got hit by a truck. And so in my recuperation period and waiting for my bike to come back from Germany, I had to figure out something interesting to check off the bucket list. And North Korea wasn't on the bucket list, but as soon as somebody told me that there was a marathon there, I wrote it on the bucket list and I decided to check it off. So I took a flight from, there's only like one flight that goes from mainland China there. There's like one major line. And so I flew into North Korea and I decided to do the marathon. I did the 10K as opposed to the half or the full. And it was a really amazing trip. And I mean, you get off the plane, they check all
Yep, he's coming back. He'll be back in a sec. Anyway, so while Matt gets connection, he was telling us about his story. So we're still going through some photos.
Okay, am I there? Am I there?
Yep, you're back. Okay. Continue, sir. Continue.
Anyways, I'm going to rifle through this. It's very interesting. You know, they have a bunch of rules. Like, for example, you shouldn't take a picture without a head-to-toe shot of any statue of the leaders. Mm-hmm. And so I kind of I faux pod that one just to fit it in. Sorry about that.
Sorry, rebel.
Anyways, anyways, you know, one of the interesting things, this is the Juche Tower, right? Am I pronouncing it right, Zoe? Juche.
Yeah.
And, you know, they like to make sure that everything is a little bit bigger. They're like, you know, there's a similar tower in XYZ, but ours is 10 meters taller. You know, there's. Have you heard of the Arch de Triomphe? Well, ours is the Arch of Triomphe, and it is 10 feet taller. You know, so it was very, very interesting. And even this is the how do you pronounce it? The
Ryugyong.
This hotel is incredible.
Oh, we lost.
It was built. Am I lost? Am
no,
I there?
Yeah.
Okay. It was built with the assistance of the Russians, and they kind of ran out of money, so it's sort of hollowed out on the inside. And man, I would love to have gone there. I never really got the chance.
My understanding, it was an Egyptian mobile company, Oracom.
Yes, there have been several people kind of dip in and dip out of funding by one. Yeah. Hmm.
But yeah, I ran the marathon. This was Kim Il-sung Stadium. There was 150,000 North Koreans that were cheering me on, and they had like paratroopers and all sorts of amazing things. I mean, you know, I think, Zoe, one of the things that only you and maybe me and maybe Daniel, depending on what he did, can appreciate is the roar of the crowd, the
just
unison
incredible.
Roar of thousands of North Koreans. It's a different sort of roar. Then, like, say, a Super Bowl roar or something. It is a very unique this tonal roar.
Yeah,
pretty.
Like, I mean, like you, I also did 10K, and one of my most amazing memories is running into Kim Il Sung Stadium and just that roar.
Yeah.
It is incredible. Yeah,
it's incredible. Yeah. It's incredible. Anyways, it was amazing. I was there with 800 people from all over the world. If you guys have a chance to go to North Korea, it's a great way to hitch a ride on an existing trip because they're still doing the marathons, right, Zoe? I mean, other than COVID, I mean, obviously.
Other than COVID, yes. Yes. Yeah. So it's one of the coolest times to be in the country for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. I think we're doing good, right? We're about 100 hour and 42 minutes. Does anybody have anything else to add that they'd like to tack on?
I just think it's good, a very nice discussion, and how the YouTube community actually finds out these things. You know, we all watch each other's videos, and you know, was watching you a while back here, Zoe. Maybe we can just do a bit of a round and how people can find your channel, and Matt, or I'll roll it over to you, Matt, and you can kind of do the roundup.
Okay, I'll roll it back to you, Alex. You go ahead and do your sign up first.
Well, anyway, I really want to thank you, Zoe, for coming on here and, you know, in sharing some of your videos with us. It was interesting. If you guys didn't know that Zoe is in an isolated island currently away from COVID, and we had to get the data from her recent trip to North Korea over to Matt, which Matt then brought you guys into the show so we could have a nice inside look on North Korea. I just want to say thank you to my audience that has joined today. A little bit of two little plugs today. One is I'm coming out with a documentary called Wuhan, called Blaming Wuhan, the documentary. It's 48 minutes long and took me about a month and a half to make. That's one plug. And the second plug is just want to say thank you to all the people that are you know, supporting our channels, and as well as who are moderators. Caliber Wings, thank you. And Jerry Good, used to be called This Is China. If you still want to stick around after the show and go over and visit his channel for some live streams, it's Jerry Good. If he's in there, Jerry, just tell everybody how to find you. And that's from me. Okay, I'm done, guys.
All right, Daniel, go ahead and give us a sign off.
Yeah, so just the same kind of a thing. Thanks very much. I do want to finish our last Super Chat question I got that came in, because it's kind of actually interesting. Asking if Trump is liked in North Korea. And then the question about who do we think is going to win, but let's leave that one alone because we're not going to get into U.S. politics. But have you ever asked anybody, Zoe, sorry to break the flow of wrapping this up, but that's a really good question. Have you ever asked anybody if they what they think about Trump, or you don't really get into that?
Yeah, no, for sure. They talk about politics all the time. They're incredibly interested in what is going on in foreign politics. Also because they get things like maybe a few days later sometimes. So if we're there and things are going on, then they'll be like, Zoe, what's happening? You know, and sometimes I have access to internet and stuff. So, but yeah, they loved Trump at first. You know, he was great. He was doing all this diplomatic stuff. He went, they shook hands at the DMZ. That was the most bizarre day. I was in North Korea on my way to the DMZ. And I was reading this information on my phone, like, what? Donald Trump's there and he's invited Kim. Isn't that funny? And then it was like, oh, wait, no, Kim's there. And they're shaking hands. It's weird. And I was telling my Korean colleagues and they were like, what? So, no, they loved Donald Trump. Very big past.
Hell, they wrote love letters together. I mean, they were
exactly. But I think a lot of the Koreans, especially the ones that I work with, they've kind of seen through it all, and it seems to be of a little bit of a bit of a Donald Trump show. He was just kind of doing it anyway, that's American politics.
A little note to the world there: if the North Koreans can see through his bullshit, I'm just saying.
So what I want to wrap up with my plug then is that I recommend everybody watch Max Blumenthal's documentary on the NED, because what was really interesting was after that meeting that Trump had, there was a whole system that went into action to undo any possible kind of friendships or collaborations that were happening. Because you got to remember, I mean, everybody knows about Chinese propaganda, North Korean propaganda. Not many people know about American propaganda, and a lot of money has been invested into the narrative about North Korea. So when they saw Donald Trump and the leader of North Korea shaking hands with each other and doing that, there was a whole system that came into play. All of the old activists or the escapees came out talking and saying, what would you do if you saw somebody shaking Hitler's hand and all this kind of stuff? And so I think people need to keep that in mind. Who knows? Maybe he could have been well-intentioned, but I think in the back, and they said, no. We've invested too much money in this. And it's just something for people to consider. I know I said I wasn't going to get political, but that's my only plug I've got. And other than that, you know, really appreciate you joining us, Zoe. It's been really interesting.
Yeah, Zoe.
Yeah. All right. Well, thank you. Yeah. Thank you very much for having me, guys. It's been amazing to have this opportunity to kind of have a bigger platform to share the kind of message that I want to share about North Korea, which is without getting involved in politics and propaganda and stuff like that, because that's what the rest of the media does. I like to talk about the people and kind of what it's really like there, on the level of without politics and government and stuff like that. I just like to get on a human level. So thanks for the opportunity, for giving me the platform. And if you guys, we've talked about a lot, and like after a tour to North Korea, most people leave with more questions than they started with. So if you guys also feel the same way, you can head over to my YouTube, which is Zoe Discovers. And I have like series North Korean FAQs and stuff like that. If you have a question that you want me to answer, then let me know and I can make a video on that or answer you super quickly in the comments and stuff like that. So yeah, thanks guys.
Very cool. Thank you very much, Zoe. I don't know. I have a lot more to talk about with regards to North Korea. And if this goes over well, and if you think you'd like to bring Zoe back on or do another one of these, I would be more than happy to moderate because there's a lot of actual nuts and bolts stories that I didn't even get into. I felt
we only just touched the surface. Really well.
Yeah, we really just touched the surface. It's an interesting country and an interesting topic. Thank you guys so much for joining us in this conversation. And thank you, Alex, Daniel, and Zoe. Me personally, I have a channel, a JaYoe Nation. I have some interesting topics coming up. It's the election is coming up. I plan to do a little bit more regarding that. And then I hope that I can put this whole American craziness to bed for a little while and focus more on traveling and things like this. Tomorrow, I am going to Shanxi with a group of YouTubers. Daniel, you're not going, right?
I'm not. No. Yeah.
Okay. And so I'm going to be spending a week there. We got a lot of amazing things. I got some fun little videos with Guelo 60 as he drinks beer across the world and enjoys culture along the way as well. And I have just a bunch of really interesting things. So check out my channel. Check out everybody's channel. All of the links are in the description. And Zoe, if anybody has any questions about traveling to North Korea, I'm sure
or Tonga.
You can answer those. Or Tonga.
Yeah.
Yeah, paradise.
I'm the expert on Tonga now, trust me.
How much more time until you think you can get out of there? What's the ETA, you think? You're stuck in
I'm planning Christmas. I'm planning my Christmas. So
Jeez. Yeah. Have fun. make a sand snowman, you know, or something.
Right? Yeah.
So take it easy, guys. Thank you very much. And we will catch you on the next one. Stay cool, JaYoe. And thanks again. Bye.
Thanks, guys.
Bye.